Not tonight, but this morning is for you, and I want to talk with you just for a few moments about your call. Someone shout my call. Now, I'm going to say this. Our world is jacked up. You say, oh, it's not that bad. You better wake up and smell the coffee, friend. Our culture ain't getting any better. It's getting worse. And I'm not just talking about because Bruce wants to be Caitlin, okay? I'm not talking about because a dude wants to be a chick. I'm not talking about that. I will say when he stands before God, he'll be Bruce. And I'm not just talking about same-sex marriage. And I'm not even talking about because I can go into Target in the women's bathroom. I'm not talking about the Orlando shooting. I'm not talking about any other tragedy we've had. I'm talking about our nation is racked with AIDS and rape and government corruption and racism and gangs and drive-by shootings. And on and on and on the list goes. We got alcoholism, pornography, drug addiction. The Ten Commandments have been thrown out. Prayer is out of schools. There's now denominations that are ordaining practicing homosexuals. We're going the wrong way. And so now more than ever, we as a church have got to rise up and say, man, what was I created for? Every one of you have a purpose. It's not fair for you to come in here and soak up the free air conditioning and just take a seat. Every one of you can make a deposit into the vision of this house. Every one of you can make a deposit into what Refuge Church is doing. You have a call of God on your life. So I'm going to put it in one sentence. Your faith has got to mean more outside these four walls than it does in here. I'm all delighted with you clapping and shouting in here. I want to know what kind of shout you got out there when all the shouting is done in here. What kind of shout do you have at work? What kind of shout do you have in your neighborhood? What kind of shout do you have in your school? Your shouts in here are awesome. They're for Jesus. But somebody has got to look at your life outside these walls and see what you're made of. So you got to figure out your calling. So in other words, when you look at your life, rather than saying, well, this is what I was educated in, rather than saying, well, this is what people tell me I ought to do, I'm asking you, church, what is it in your life that when you do it, it makes you feel whole? What is it in your life that when you do it, there's just something inside you that says, man, this is what I was created to do. This is what I love to do. Every one of you are passionate about something. Every one of you are excited when you do certain things. It's what you were created to do. So when you look at your life, what is it that when you do it, you just go, man, this is something inside me says, this is what I was created for. There's an old movie out there called Chariots of Fire. How many of you remember that movie? Raise your hand. Lots of you do. How many don't know Chariots of Fire? Because some of you weren't even a sparkle in your mom and dad's eye yet. Amen. But I'm going to tell you how the movie goes. It's an older movie, but it's about a family of missionaries. It's an Oscar award-winning movie. We're about to have the Olympics in just a few short days. Undoubtedly, they will play sometime in that 17 days the Chariots of Fire theme. It's famous. But there is this movie about a family of missionaries. They're in ministry, but one is very passionate about running. He has a dream to run in the Olympics. It gets him up every day. It fuels him. It burns within him. And so he gets up every day and he trains and he runs and he runs and he trains and he runs. And there's a scene in the movie, man, y'all better Netflix it. You better rent it. Do whatever you gotta do just to find this one scene. He has a collision with his family. They're actually ticked off that he gets up and is so driven by this. And so in the movie, he has an argument with one of his family members. And they look at him and they say, why do you run all the time? You get up every day and you run and you run and you run and you're so possessed by this dream to run in the Olympics. You're supposed to be a missionary. And he looks at his family and man, what he says is priceless. He looks them dead in the face and he says, but when I run, I feel God's pleasure. Whew. Friends, what is it that when you do it, you feel God's pleasure? Because that's the call of God on your life. I used to think the opposite. I used to think God called you to do something you hated doing. Because I always heard Christians whine and gripe and complain. Can I say that Christians are the biggest, fattest babies on the face of the planet? Can I tell you, I can go to a bar and I can take a drunk and he can handle problems better than church folks. You say, what do you mean? You hear people all the time at church, well, I hate it, but I'm doing it. Glory to God. Hey, what are you doing? I'm serving here. I can't stand it, but I'm doing it for Jesus. It's like, really? You're like, what do you mean? Okay, I'll give you a couple examples. Hey, could you help us out with VBS? Well, okay. You're like, wow. Hey, could you help us out being a greeter at the door? Well, blah, 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 I guess so. Hey, could you help us out on the prayer team, the worship team? Hey, could you help us out with our outreach? Well, all right. You're like, man, God must call you to do something that's terrible. Because I always heard Christians whine and complain. And I'm not saying that there aren't hard moments. And I'm not saying that there aren't times that you and I won't struggle. What I am saying is God doesn't call you to do something that you weren't made to do. And when you do it, you'll sense that it's right. And you'll sense that that's who you are. And you'll sense that that's who you were created to be. Many years ago, when I started ministry straight out of Bible college, I went to be a youth pastor at a church in Arkansas, and our church very much had a vision for Mexico. I just honor the pastor. He had a vision for Mexico. He had a heart for Mexico, and so when he started the church, pastor, it was a pretty cool deal because he said, this church will never exist without in the same year we build another church in Mexico, and he said, the next year our church exists, we will match it with another church in Mexico. They did it every year. It was amazing. He would get up every single year at the beginning of the year and say, guys, it's time to build another church in Mexico. And he would cast the vision and he would take pledges. Everybody would give a pledge throughout the year. All the pledges would come in the fall. When all the pledges and money had been collected, they would assemble a team together. They would go over with the money and the team. They would throw up kind of a metal building, you know, kind of throw up a metal building, get the team, get a couple of missionaries in place, have a two-week revival and build a church. They built over 73 churches. Come on, somebody, for the kingdom of God in Mexico. When I say they went to Mexico, please know they didn't go to the beach and play volleyball and pass out tracts and call it a trip. They went to the ghetto. They went to the barrio. Can I tell you, they went to the places where there was no running water and little kids' stomachs were swelled out and there was no electricity. I'm talking about they went to the real deal. People were living in cardboard boxes. Now, I was a youth pastor, and every year, undoubtedly, some of my teenagers would always want to go on the trip. They'd always come to me, oh, Pastor Michael, I want to go. Oh, let me go. I want to go to Mexico. I was always hesitant to let the teenagers go, because how many of you know teenagers don't really work? Can you get a what? I mean, come on. They don't really work. Come on, Mom and Dad. I tell my son, clean your room. Ah! You know, like I asked him to donate his liver or something like that. My son's like, Dad, I've got a callus. I'm like, yeah, from the Xbox, but it's not from digging a ditch. Let's just be real. Teenagers don't really got the work ethic down. So I would always let them go. Can I tell y'all, that first day, they were working. They were working. They were out there working. I'm telling you, those kids were out there. They were digging ditches. And man, they were helping somebody build a header. And they had wood and had a hammer. And they were carrying a bag of quickcrete. That first day, they're out there working. That second day, it was always about that third day. You know, that the kids were out there running around in the streets, playing with little kids, you know. We would take over a bunch of toothbrushes, and they were passing out toothbrushes as gifts. And some of you, toothbrush, it's not a gift. Well, that's spoiled like we are here in Denison. They had toothbrushes, and they were glad to have them. We gave a kid a can of Coke. How many of y'all have today, like 10? We gave a kid a can of Coke. We saw him 3 days later. He still had the can of Coke in his hand. This kid had not even opened it. He was walking around with a can of soda like it was a piece of gold or something. And so now some of my teenagers, no longer are they building the physical church, you know, with like wood and nails and stuff. But now they were still building a church, but they just weren't doing work. Now they were out there doing a different kind of work. They were loving kids, and they were playing with kids, and they were bouncing kids around. They were swinging kids around like this, and they were kind of doing puppet shows, and they were kind of blowing up balloon animals. And one of my girls, her name is Allison, right? She was only 16 years old. She was so pumped. She comes home, Pastor Larry, and she's like, Pastor Michael, now I know. I'm like, what are you talking about? She said, now I know. I said, what do you mean? She said, now I know what I'm supposed to do in my life. And I said, what? She said, play with kids. She said, isn't that amazing? And I said, really? And she said, yeah. And all of a sudden, the call of God on her life was some great big thing that she didn't even know was there. The call of God on her life was to play with children, was to love children, was to be with children. Are you ready for this? She is now a children's pastor in Corinth, Texas, pastoring 300 kids every single Sunday. Come on, somebody. Sometimes God moves in ways that'll blow us away. So I'm asking you, what do you love to do? You say, well, I've had some classes in. I didn't ask you what you had classes in. What do you love to do? You say, well, people have always told me I didn't ask what people said. What do you love to do? You're like, well, you know, what I like isn't that churchy. I didn't ask you if it was churchy. What do you love to do? Because when you find that thing, that's the call of God in your life. Can I get an amen? Every one of you are special. Every one of you are unique. How many of you know every one of you are amazing? Can I get an amen? God is not in the business of making little carbon copy, cookie cutter, itty bitty, ticky tacky little Christians. We all look the same, dress the same, worship the same, smell the same. We're all different. God would never duplicate you. God created you, and when he looked at you, he said, I'll never do that again. So see, you are special. I found it interesting that Pastor would talk about our brother today. Is he really an MMA fighter? Okay, that's pretty cool, because I got a story to tell you. We had a guy in our church, and he was an MMA fighter. That's what he loved to do. Matter of fact, he was so passionate about beating people up that's what he does for a living. He didn't even have another job. He's a professional fighter. That's it. And I have to tell you, do we have any MMA UFC fans? Do you like a little UFC? I dig me some UFC. I'm not into boxing. Boxing's for fairies. Let me tell you why. Because they put pillows on their hands. They put pillows on their hands. And they dance around. And they get little sequin draws on. No, if you're going to man up, get in the octagon and punch someone in the face. Right? I watched that Mayweather-Pacquiao fight. They hugged each other more than I hug my spouse. Okay? So, got to understand, if you're going to do it, right? Boxing, come on. Don't put pillows on your hands and sequin draws on. Get in there and punch someone in the face. So, I'm all about it. I'm a big fan. So, we had two MMA fighters in our church. And so they brought this dude, okay? They brought this guy to our church. This brother wasn't saved, okay? This dude was going to hell. I'm just telling you right now. Unless he had an encounter with Jesus, his future wasn't bright. He had never been in church. He had never darkened the door of a church. He would even joke with me, Pastor, I don't know if I should come in. The walls may cave in. You don't know where I was last night. You don't know what I was doing at the club. I'm like, dude, we're just glad you're here. We just want you to come. We just love Jesus. So Jason kept coming. He kept coming and coming and coming. It was like, and he really started liking it. He started out on back row. It's kind of funny. I watched the whole progression. Then he could move up a little bit. He moved up a little bit. Before you know, he was on the front row. Ready for this? About 3 months into coming, he came down on altar, cried a bucket of tears, and gave his heart to Jesus Christ. Isn't that awesome? It was awesome. Now it's funny. He's coming to church, man. He's got his little Bible, right? I'm like, turn to the book of Isaiah, and it takes him like 10 minutes to find it, but he's smiling. He's flipping and smiling. He's loving people, okay? Now it's funny, because now every time he had a fight, he would call me for prayer. It was so funny. He called me up, hey, Pastor Michael, guess what? I'm like, what's up? He said, man, I got a fight tomorrow night. I'm like, cool. He said, would you pray for me? I said, absolutely. What are we agreeing for? He said, man, pray that I crush this guy's face. How do you do that? I don't even know how to do that. Lord, help him crush his face. And geez, I can't do that. So, you know, I would just say, Lord, through his training and his abilities, you know, help him to be victorious, you know, whatever, throw him a bone, whatever. So Mark Cuban, you guys might know, you know, from Dallas Mavs and Shark Tank, he has something down in the AA Center called HDNet Fights, and a lot of the guys, you know, that are doing this really like to try to get in there for one of those HDNet fights. I've been told it's kind of your gateway into the UFC, and so anyway, he got a fight down there, and so we all went down to support him, right? Spike TV, a show called The Ultimate Fighter. He was in talks with them about being on The Ultimate Fighter, so you know, all these things were happening in his life. He's serving Jesus, and we went down to support him, right? He wins, right? He gets a belt. He's like, awesome. So flash to 3 months later, he calls me on the phone. He's like, Pastor, guess what? I'm like, what? He said, I'm starting a Bible study. I said, really? At the church? He goes, nope, in the octagon. I'm like, what? He said, I'm starting a Bible study in the octagon. I said, what do you mean? He said, man, I'm a champ. He said, I got a belt. He said, guys want me to train them. He said, but I decided I'm not going to train them until they come to my Bible study. So they're coming to the Bible study, getting saved, then they beat each other up. How cool is that? It's totally crazy. I got another friend named Jimmy, and he's a freak. You're like, come on, man. No, he's a freak. You just got to call it where you see it. You're like, don't be so harsh. No, this cat is a freak. He's got multicolored hair. It's crazy. It's like, it looks like Rainbow Bright threw up on his head. No, seriously. it looks like Strawberry Shortcake, My Little Pony all got together and vomited on his face. It's like Disneyland. Okay, he's pierced, he's tatted, he got black fingernail, he's leather and all this stuff. He's got this thing on his face. You're like, what is it? It's a beard. It's not a beard. You're like, oh, it's a soul patch. Nope, not a soul patch. You're like, a goatee. No, it's like this Fu Manchu that hangs off his face. And it's braided and it's yellow and green, okay? He's 57. That's the funniest part of the story. It's the funniest part of the story, okay? So he's got this band, and I don't even know how to explain it. It's Christian, but it's like rap. It's like rock. It's like Christian, but it's like rap. It's like rap core rock. It's like Larnell Harris meets Lil Wayne. You know, it's weird. It's like the Gaithers meets Limp Bizkit. I don't know. It's crazy. It's like Jay-Z and Kanye got together with Sandy Patty and had a baby. It's weird. It's like it's Christian, but it's rock, but it's rap. So he calls me on the phone. He's like, Pastor Michael, you need to come to one of our joint nights. I'm like, brother, I don't smoke weed anymore. He's like, no, not a joint. He goes, it's a joint night. I'm like, bro, I was born in 68. I don't know what a joint is to you, but I can tell you what a joint means to me. So he had to explain to me what a joint night was. A joint night is when these jokers get a flatbed trailer and they just roll into a Walmart parking lot and just put on a concert. Just like it's totally unannounced. You know, you sing like flash mobs, it's like a flash concert. And they just pull up, that's it. And so he's like, you gotta come. I'm like, cool, this sounds like a party, I'm gonna come. So here we are, and we roll up to this Walmart parking lot, and they got their leather and chains and stuff, and they're turning everything up to ear bleed, and they're all queuing up. I'm like, dude, there's nobody here. He's like, you just need to wait for it. I was like, bro, there's nobody here. He's like, just wait for it. And I'm like, there's nobody here. He's like, just wait for it. I said, did you even ask for permission? He's like, no, we'll ask for forgiveness. I was like, oh, okay, well, you know, whatever works for you. That's like, I'm like, we're going to get arrested, okay? So they start this. I don't even know how to explain it, y'all. It was like, I couldn't even catch a word. Every now and then I would catch the word Jesus. It was like, Jesus. I'm like, Jesus, I caught that right there. I heard that. That was Jesus. Heard you say Jesus. La, la. Y'all, these students came out of the cracks like roaches at a cheap motel. It was ridiculous. They're all coming out flipping on their skateboards. They're smacking into each other. They're punching each other. They're coming out on their bikes. It's like, oh, it's like a Warp Tour, right? It just exploded. And they're all body surfing and stuff. And I'm like, wow, I'm scared. And they're all rocking up and down. So he gets his concert after about 30 minutes. When he's got this big crowd, about 150 kids, he throws down his guitar. He starts preaching a gospel. He starts talking about how he got out of gangs and out of jail and out of pornography. I saw a kid get saved and baptized in the Holy Ghost in the middle of a Walmart parking lot. Come on, somebody. And a religious person always says, well, brother, I don't know about, oh, shut up. They'd never darken the door of this church. But you know what? That's his thing. He's found what he loves to do. And he's using that to win people to Jesus. I'm not going to listen to that. I'm not going to grow that thing off my face. I'm not going to wear, it's not my thing. But that's his thing. And so I'm asking you, what are you passionate about? What do you love to do? Because when you find that thing, that's the call of God on your life. What can you do to be a part of Refuge Church? What can we do to take this gospel outside these four walls and absolutely impact this city for the, well, you know, there's only 250 of us. Oh, please. We were a church in Pensacola, Florida, and before we knew it, and Father's Day of 1995, an evangelist named Steve Hill came to our church. And from that moment forward, over the next 7.5 years, we had 9 million people come through our church doors. We had 500,000 documented salvations. I saw people wait 17 hours to get into church. Can you imagine having church at 7 o'clock and ending about 8, 9, 10, 11, midnight, and at 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning, the line would start forming for the next night service? Can I tell you the power of God was so strong, custodians couldn't even go in and clean the building. You know how many times I walked in the sanctuary and there'd be a custodian laid out with a running vacuum cleaner speaking in tongues. It looked like a drive-by shooting or something. Like, it was crazy. It was nuts. And once you've been a part of that atmosphere, you never want to go back to church the same. What do you love to do? When you find that thing, that's how you can pursue God's call on your life. Can I get an amen? Do you remember the disciples in Matthew chapter 16? I remember because right here in my notes. The Bible says that the disciples had been following Jesus for about a year and a half. Pastor Larry, they'd seen Jesus do some incredible things. Isn't it amazing how sometimes we get desensitized to the Word of God? Have you ever noticed that sometimes we read things over and over and over, and we just hear them so much after a while, we just get glazed over. We're just adjusted and acclimated. It just doesn't impact us the way that it used to when we first heard it. Like right now, when I think of the miracles of Jesus, how incredible that was. Like I could say right now, Jesus walked on water. Look at y'all. You sounded like a library. It was ridiculous. I just said, Jesus walked on water. I heard one guy, amen. Someone said, yes. Praise the Lord. You should have like went postal. You want to know why? Because it's a miracle. It's a miracle. And he walked on top. He didn't sink. He walked on the top. It's a miracle. If you all went right now to Dallas, to Hawaiian Falls Water Park, got in the wave pool, and just walked on top saying, hey, how's it going? How's everybody doing? Everybody would be like, it'd be crazy, because it's a miracle. So I'm going to say it again, and you're going to go nuts like you should have the first time. I'll even do it evangelistic style. I want y'all to know, there was a man, his name was Jesus, and he walked on water. Oh, that was terrible, but you get what I'm saying. He raised Lazarus from the dead. He cast out devils. He fed a multitude. You're like, I know 5,000. No. That was just the men. Did you know if the theologians and historians tell us if you include women and children, 25,000 people with a happy meal. That is ridiculous. Some of you got two kids. You can't get out of Chick-fil-A for less than $20. This dude feeds a stadium with a kid's sack lunch. That's amazing. And the disciples saw this. They're just regular dudes, Pastor. And they're seeing him walk on water and cast out demons and speak to an ocean and calm it down, raise the dead, make the lame walk in the blind see. And the disciples are getting to hang out with this dude. How many know if you're the disciples and you're hanging out with Jesus, you got to be feeling pretty good about yourself. You're hanging out with the Son of God. That's a pretty cool hang. Have you ever met anybody famous and their fame kind of rubs off on you? Like, have you ever been in an airport or something, you saw somebody like, you like kind of geeked out? I don't know, like I was down in Uptown and I saw Mark Cuban and Tony Romo was there. And you know, it's just, you know, if you ever just seen somebody, you're like, you know, just like, look who it is. I used to think people like this were just bona fide losers. I've had people come to me in church, look at that, see that? Dale Earnhardt. You see that? Dale Earnhardt. He signed that with a Sharpie. Signed it right there on my boobie, right there. Dale Earnhardt. See that on that? That's a Sharpie on my t-shirt right there on my boobie. That's Dale Earnhardt. Like, so what? He's a dude, right? See that right there? See that right there? Dirk Nowitzki, see that right there on my boob? See that on my t-shirt? That's Dirk Nowitzki. Went down the Mavericks game. I waited outside 14 hours. And Dirk came out and he signed that right there. See that right there? Dirk Nowitzki. You're a loser. You're just a loser. What do you care? He's just a dude. Puts on his pant legs one leg at a time, just like all of us. You need to get a life, right? And then it happened to me. I gotta tell you a story. It's too funny. All right, how many have ever been to Branson, Missouri? Have you ever been to Branson? Okay. You all know Branson. It's like the Christian Vegas. Anyway, so I'm in Branson. There used to be a cat there named Cecil Todd, and he did these things called Revival Fires Camp Meeting. And I don't even know if it's open anymore. It closed down, it opened up, closed down, opened up. But right there in the biggest part of the main strip is called the Grand Palace. It's like the biggest thing there in Branson. It seats about 5,000-6,000 people. And it's the first time I ever got to do a conference with John Hagee and T.D. Jakes. So I'm standing there in the back room. It's John Hagee and it's T.D. T.D. Jakes! T.D. Jakes! And there's a little voice in my head going, you're the weakest one here, goodbye. I'm thinking, what am I even doing standing here with these like mega giant men of the faith? You know, but it was pretty cool. I kind of geeked out a little bit. So I went home. The revival was going on. And there was a guy named Bishop Tudor Bismarck. This man is unbelievable. He's from Zimbabwe, Harare. He's got a crazy apostolic anointing over his life, prophetic anointing. Pastor, he's brilliant. He's an Oxford grad. I mean, speaks with articulation and diction. Rick, it's amazing. So I called Pastor Kilpatrick on the phone one night. I said, I did a conference with this cat from Harare. His name's Tudor Bismarck. We need to have him. It's amazing. Pastor said, set it up. Make it happen. Set it all up. He flew in from Africa. There that night at the revival, there's about 7,000 people there. The place is packed. I'm on the front row. Bishop's got his robe on. He's up there thundering away preaching. All of a sudden, true story, it happened just like this. He stops. Right in the middle of his message, just stops. He looks over at me and he says, Michael, stand up. And so I stood up. He said, Michael, put your hands out like this. So I did this. He said, Michael, I'm going to put my hands forward because I'm going to speak prophetically over you. Your hands are like this because you're going to receive it. He said, Michael, God just spoke and said that Hollywood is going to open up to you. He said, celebrities are going to come into your path. He said, people of fame and notoriety, people of great popularity and fortune are going to come into your path. No one else can minister to them. No one else can talk to them. But God is going to give you divine encounters. Receive it in Jesus' name. And I went, whatever. Because I'm thinking, come on, really? Hollywood, Tudor, come on. You missed it this time. Are y'all ready for this? I'm not talking about the next year. I'm not talking about in a different season of my life. I'm talking the next 6 to 7 weeks in a row that I got on an airplane, a major celebrity came and sat down right next to me. So I get on this airplane, and then again, this will probably mean nothing to you younger, but to you older people. So Pete Rose comes and sits down right next to me on an airplane. Now, again, I know for you younger, that's nothing. But for you old people, it's Pete Rose. He's almost a Hall of Famer. It's Pete Rose. Literally invented the front slide. I'm like, oh, I'm geeking out. I call my friend, Pete Rose. He's sitting next to me. He's like, ooh, ask him if he's got a line on anything. No, he didn't say that. I'm sorry. It's terrible. I know, right? I shouldn't have said that. Anyway, it was Pete Rose. It was kind of funny. I get on the plane the next week. Again, this will be nothing to you young people. Okay? But I go to London. I'm sitting there in London Heathrow Airport, and Robin Gibb from the Bee Gees, right? Right, and I'm like, Robin Gibb. I'm singing Bee Gees songs, night fever, singing all the, it was Robin Gibb. It was kind of cool. I get on the plane next week, Regis Philbin comes and says, it's Regis Philbin. There's the next week. I get on the plane the next week. This will mean nothing to you old people, okay? But it was Little John and the Ying Yang Twins. Now, I got to tell you the story. So Little John and Ying Yang Twins get on the plane, and my arm member's like, it's Little John. I'm like, Little Flip. He's like, no, Little John. I said, Little Wayne. He's like, no, Little John. I was like, why is he little? What's the Ying? What's the Yang? Hey, you know what's going on? But they're all there, and he's got his hat. He's got his grill and his ice. He's got his crunk thing. He's like, ha, ha. I'm like, hey. He said, what? I said, hey. He said, what? I said, hey. He said, what? I said, huh? He said, okay. It was nuts. It was ridiculous. It was Little John Ying Yang Twins. All he said the whole time, what? 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 I was like, huh? He goes, okay, it was nuts. So I get on a plane the next week, and this dude gets on the plane, right? He's got his hat on, right? He's got his Harley Davidson t-shirt, his big old black leather vest, his belt buckle, right? Walking on the plane, right? I didn't even know who it was. Turns out it was Travis Tritt, okay? And that's country. So, oh, I know where I'm at. I know what state I'm in. I'm just not down. I'll take young country, a little rocky, but I can't do down in the down in the, you know. Can't do it. Sorry. I don't even own a pair of boots. Anyway, it's Travis Tritt. I was kind of geeking out. So, get on plane the next week. Evander Holyfield, former heavyweight champion of the world, gets on a plane. Pastor sits down next to me. I'm trying not to stare at his ear, right? But I did. I'm like, don't stare at his ear. Don't stare at his ear. But I stared at his ear. It's there. It's crazy. I start talking to Evander Holyfield. I invite him to my church. He comes to my church and ministers at my church. Afterwards, I'm going out to eat with Evander Holyfield. I'm walking into a restaurant with Evander the real deal. I'm like, yeah, me and Evander, table for two. We're buddies. We're together. Table for two. Me and Evander. So I get on the plane the next week, and this lady sits down next to me, and all of a sudden, y'all, this light-skinned brother gets on the plane. Now, I got to tell y'all, this dude was so good looking. I don't want y'all to think I'm a Fruit Loop. I'm married to a woman. I'm just saying the dude was fine. You got to give honor where honor's due. The dude was hot with two teeth. This sucker was photoshopped in real life. I was like, holy moly, so fine. And he's got, you know, he's like just chiseled. Man, he had a six-pack. Looked like his shirt was just painted on. Just six-pack. Had his Louis Vuitton bag just walking down the aisle. And I was like, good Lord, that dude's fine. All of a sudden, this lady next to me loses her mind. She's all, ooh, ooh. I looked at her and said, calm down. I'm just a preacher. She said, don't you know? Don't you know? I looked at her and I went, no. She said, man, that's Shamar Moore from Criminal Minds. Oh my God. Healing to all these ladies in Jesus' name. Did you see that? I just mentioned his name. Ladies were like, oh, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Let Shamar know you in a real way so that I could meet him. I said, lady, I don't know. I don't watch Criminal Minds. Who's Shamar Moore? She goes, he used to host Soul Train. I said, does it look like I watch Soul Train? She said, he was Malcolm on The Young and the Restless. I said, lady, I don't watch soap operas, but I got to tell y'all, I stared at Shamar the whole flight. Look at Shamar. Wow. He going to the bathroom. He coming back. He's having some peanuts. He's having a Coke. What is my point? My point is these are phony, paper, pathetic heroes. They're just people. We put them up on pedestals. They're people. And just because they're on Oprah, or just because they wrote a book, or just because they can dunk a basketball, we put them on pedestals and say, man, look how amazing they are. What is my point? My point is the disciples were walking around with the Son of the Living God. And if I'm getting excited about a ball player, how do you think the disciples felt walking into a town with Jesus? You think they just walked in? They probably walked in, oh yeah, he's Jesus, he's Jesus. And he was like, shut up. Do you think they did it all discreet? They were probably like, hello everybody, give me a J, give me an E, and he was like, shut up, you're embarrassing me. And then the little kids tried to come to Jesus. Remember that? Little kids tried to come to Jesus. What'd the disciples do? Hey, you kids, get out of here. You get out of here. That's Jesus Christ. He's famous and I'm his friend. Then what did Jesus do? He looked at them and said, hey, you don't let those little kids come to me. You're out of the kingdom. Then what they do? Hey, kids, come here. He has candy. Sit on his lap. Seriously, he has Tootsie Rolls. Sit down. And so wherever my keyboards is, I'm getting ready to close. I'm not closing, but I'm getting ready in the direction to close eventually in a few moments in a little while. Come on. She's like, do you? Okay.
Let's bring it down. So Jesus gets them all together in Jerusalem, and he says, listen, guys, you've been my disciples, you've been my best friends, you've been my buddies, you've been my, I no longer call you servants or disciples, now I call you friends. And he says, I'm going to come here to Jerusalem, and I'm going to die here. And the disciples go, well, Jesus, you're just 30-something years old. I mean, people are just starting to hear about you. You're doing all these miracles. We're going to wipe out the Romans. You're going to be the king. And he says, no. He said, I came here to Jerusalem, and I came to die. And he did. And you know what, Refuge Church? I have a very sneaking suspicion that we're very much like the disciples. See, the disciples wanted Jesus to walk them down the yellow brick road. And Jesus said, no, you want to follow me, you got to follow me down the Via Dolorosa. You see, when Jesus was around, the disciples felt safe. When Jesus was around and they got to hang out with him, the disciples felt secure. When Jesus was among them, the disciples said, man, we can do anything in the world. We got this miracle-working Son of God. He's our friend. Man, let's do this. And then the moment Jesus said, I got to go away, then that started freaking the disciples out. Can I tell you something, friends? Jesus is not always the one that walks you down the yellow brick road. Sometimes you want to follow Jesus, you got to follow him to the cross. The call of the Christian faith is not to stay in the safe zone. The call of the Christian faith is to allow God to push you out into some areas of risk and danger, because that's the only way that we learn things sometimes. Did you know that the thorn room is the way to the throne room? Did you know that sometimes you're going to go through pain? Sometimes you're going to go through heartache. Sometimes you're going to go through loss. Sometimes you're going to go through all kinds of obstacles. But sometimes God allows us in these places in life because he's molding us and he's shaping us and he's perfecting us. And he's wanting you to pursue the call on your life. Ministry is not just something that a paid staff of professionals do. Ministry is something that everybody does. Ministry is something that everybody gets involved in. The moment you came to this church and you said yes to Jesus, there's a call of God on your life. There's a purpose for your life. And see, some of you, when you got saved, you thought, hey, safety. But in reality, it was danger. We all go through different conversions in life. First is the conversion of meaning. I'm sure a lot of you, if not most of you, have been through that conversion. You know what the conversion of meaning is? That's when we're unsaved, but then we get saved. And Jesus comes into our heart and our life, and we're moving on with Jesus. That's the first conversion, the conversion of meaning. But then some of us went through the second conversion. You know what that is? That's the conversion of betrayal. That's when our Christianity betrays us. That's when we found out that our dad had cancer. That's when we got fired from the job. That's when we went through a divorce. That's when we struggled with an addiction. That's when we didn't get the job, or we didn't pass the test, or our best friend was in an automobile accident. That's when we were 12 years old and your mom and dad walked into your room and said, who do you want to live with, me or your mom? And you said, well, I thought we'd all live together, you know, like as a family. But it's not gonna happen. Who you want to live with, me or your mom? And for many of us, we saw a world of danger and violence and corruption. And we start looking around saying, God, where are you? I thought this Christianity thing was going to be so great. I thought this Christianity thing was going to solve all my problems. And that's what you thought. That you thought Christianity was just some great big problem solver, didn't you? You know what? I used to have a problem with pornography. Now I know Jesus. Poof, I don't have that problem anymore. You know, I used to have a problem with alcohol and cigarettes. But now I come to Refuge Church. Poof, I don't have that problem anymore. I don't know about you, but I find when I get about one or two problems solved, there's about three or four others that pop up in its place. You know what that's called? Life. And you'll find that Christianity is not about solving all of our problems. Is Jesus the answer to all my problems and all my questions? Absolutely. But all of our problems and all of our questions don't always get answered. That's why we walk by faith, not by sight.
That's why we say, God, even when you put me in some areas in my life of difficulty, I trust you anyway. I trust you for a job. I trust you for my marriage. I trust you to heal my body. I trust you to help me with my finances.
You've bought some property, and you realize, Refuge Church, you have just begun to scratch the surface of what God wants to do in this house. You have just begun, Pastor, and you can take this as a prophetic word. I speak prophetically that Refuge has just begun to see the tip of the iceberg of what God wants to do. And so now, more than ever, this body of believers have got to realize, what was I called to do? What am I passionate about? How can I make a significant deposit into the impact of this church? You're not just here to take a seat. You're not just here to be glazed over and not noticed. Every one of you are here to do something to reach this city. But so many of us can't do it, because you're so consumed with your own life. Did you know that? Pastor, we haven't all reached our potential yet here at Refuge, because so many times the enemy distracts us and he gets us so in the bubble of our own lives that we can't even see 3 feet outside the bubble of our own life to impact somebody else. I'm not gonna give an altar call for alcoholism. I'm just gonna take a stab. We're not going to find everybody in this church tonight at midnight behind some bar in a back alley struggling around passing out with a brown paper bag around a bottle. I'm not saying some of you haven't struggled with alcohol. I'm not saying that. I'm saying I don't think I'm talking to a room of alcoholics. I'm not giving an altar call today for drug addiction. I don't think that every one of you are going to go home. You're going to put all the family and loved ones in another part of the house. You're going to go in the bathroom. You're going to lock the door. You're going to run the water. You're going to wrap a little tourniquet around your arm and you're going to heat up a spoon and shoot up. I'm not saying some of you haven't struggled with drugs. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying I don't think I'm talking to a congregation of drug addicts. But I will say this. Every one of you deal with life. Every single one of you, every single day. I got to go here. I got to go there. I got to do that. Man, I got Facebook. I got Twitter. I got Instagram. I got Periscope. I got Snapchat. I got this. I got that. I gotta go here. I gotta pick up the kids. I gotta go this. I got baseball. I got football. I got cheerleading. I got this. Gotta go to the post office. Gotta go to the bank. Gotta make deposits. Gotta go to the grocery store. I got 12 loads of laundry. I gotta do this. I gotta get dinner. I gotta go here. Enough! We get so wrapped up with our own lives, so distracted with our own lives, that we can't even impact somebody else. I told you tonight at 6 o'clock, we're having a good old-fashioned soul-winning rally. What are you gonna do with the next 6 hours and 15 minutes? What are you gonna do? Will you go out and get outside of yourself for a second? Will you go home and pick up the phone? Will you go invite somebody? Will you go pick somebody up? Will you go give some? Go tell somebody I'll give you $50 if you come to church with me. I'm serious. Say, I'll take you out for pizza. Maybe they'll come for pepperoni and get Pentecost. Who knows? I was in Little Rock, Arkansas, and a guy had a Kawasaki dealership. Pastor, he told every one of his employees, I'll give you $100 if you come to church with me. Only one of his employees took him up on it because he wanted $100. Big old dude. Man, this sucker was like 4'10". This sucker was a beast. He cried like a little 4-year-old at Kmart. I'm serious. He sat back there and bawled through the whole service, ran down to the altar, collapsed on the ground, came up to me afterwards and said, Pastor Michael, I came tonight because my boss said I could have $100. But I met Jesus. I don't even want the $100. He goes, I just fell in love with Jesus tonight. That's awesome. But we can't. We're so distracted. Every one of you in this room are distracted. But you have a purpose and a destiny and a call. What are you passionate about? So I close with this story. It's a true story. Supposedly happened somewhere in Tennessee. Mike Iaconelli, who's went on home to be with the Lord, told me the story. True story about a little perfect neighborhood, a little Pleasantville. It was just a little perfect white-collar neighborhood. Nothing bad had ever happened. Everybody had good jobs. Every house was like pink and blue and yellow and little picket fences, little paper boy. Everybody had a minivan, 2 kids, a dog and a cat. Just a little perfect town. Nothing bad had ever happened. Supposedly, the story is, in the middle of the night, about 3 o'clock in the morning, a fire broke out in one of the houses of this perfect little family. Flames and smoke engulfed the house, and the dad woke up because he smelled smoke. He grabbed his wife. They're grabbing all the kids and the photo albums. They're trying to get out. Already, ambulances and police had screamed up. They were taping it off. You could hear fire trucks in the distance. People were walking out of the neighborhood, putting on their house coats, looking at this inferno of flames. And the dad is panicking. Billy, Bobby, Tammy, where's Sarah? Where's Sarah? And all of a sudden, you're daddy. And the dad looked up, and his 5-year-old daughter was in the top window of the house. True story. And the dad started running in, and the police collapsed on top of him. He said, my daughter. They said, sir, you can't go in there. He said, my daughter. They said, sir, the whole thing's about to collapse. Fire trucks will be here any second. They have ladders. We'll do the best we can. You can't go in. He said, my daughter's in there. And you can just hear, daddy, daddy. And the dad ran up to the window, and smoke and flames just engulfing the house. And the heat was just hitting up against, singeing her hair. Little 5-year-old. And she goes, daddy, daddy. And he goes, baby, I'm right here, okay? I'm right here. Just jump. She goes, daddy, where are you? Daddy, where are you? And he goes, baby, I'm right here. She goes, daddy, it's hot. Daddy, I'm burning. Daddy, I'm hot. He said, baby, just jump. I'm right here. She goes, but daddy, I can't see you. And the dad gets as close to the flames as he can. He says, baby, I can see you. I don't know where you are in your marriage. I don't know where you are at your job. I don't know what the temperature is like with your children. I don't know if you have more bills than you have income. I don't know if you've been hurt. But I came here today to tell you that the enemy is a master at putting smoke and flames all around your life, getting you in a place where you feel like you can't see God, but he sees you. He sees you. He sees you. He knows right where you are. Pastor, I can't imagine how terrifying for a child to just jump out into flames, but I can tell you her father would have caught her. Have you ever come to church and felt like everybody was getting blessed but you? Can we just be real today? For God's sakes, can we just for one time be real in church? Have you ever been to church and just everybody was getting touched and not you? Did you ever read the Bible and it's just like nothing? Did you ever pray and you just felt like your words were bouncing off a wall? Let's just face it. We've all been there. If any of you have been saved for more than a month, we all know that we go through those what I call spiritual deserts where we just don't feel God the way we used to. He feels like he's far away, but I'm telling you, he sees you. He sees you. He's looking right at you. He sees the fear. He sees your questions. He knows that you're confused. He knows that you need peace. He sees your children. He sees the thing you're battling with. He's looking at you. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, no one talking, no one looking around. And I know so many times we get so repetitive. We say every head bowed, every eye closed, and we don't really do it. I'm asking you to really do it. Because this is none of anyone's business. This is between you and God. Because of time today, I'm not going to call you forward, but I want to ask you today, if there's anyone here and you say, Pastor, that was for me. I know God has a call on my life. I know that I can do great things for this church, but I feel like the enemy has distracted me. In my life, he's put flames and smoke all around my life. There's many times where I feel very distant from God, but I realize today he sees me. If that's you and you say, I need prayer, would you raise your hand nice and high? Boom, 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 boom. Wow, wow. All around the building. Wow. Let's just all pray the prayer. It would be very appropriate. You can put your hands down. If I were to call you forward, we'd have to move every chair in the building. So let's just all pray the prayer. Will you do me a favor? Don't mumble it. Say it loud and proud. Say, Dear Heavenly Father, I love you so much. And Father, I thank you for your Son, Jesus. I thank you for the Holy Spirit. And Father, I proclaim today that I need you. I have been distracted by the enemy. There have been times in my life, Father, even now, where the enemy puts smoke and flames all around my life. The enemy has tried to get me in a place to believe that you're not looking at me. Because, Father, at times, I feel like I can't see you. But, Father, I know you see me. You see my life. You see my marriage. You see my children. You see my health, my finances, my job. You're looking at me. And I come before you today, putting my hope and my faith and my trust in you. I will be distracted no longer. Help me, Father, to pursue the call that you have placed upon my life. And I'll give you all the praise in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, somebody put your hands, come on, clap your hands, shout into God with a voice of triumph. Come on, praise him. Come on, give him an ovation. He's Alpha, Omega, beginning and the end, Lily of the Valley, Sweet Rose of Sharon, Triumphant Lion of Judah, give him praise. Sit down. Hallelujah. Did that help somebody today? I pray that it did. Listen, every one of you have a call on your life. Who would have ever thought that a guy I know that just used to punch people in the face would start a Bible study in an octagon? Who would have ever thought that a friend of mine who just liked to rock and rap and rock out would lead people to Jesus in a parking lot of a Walmart? Pastor, I didn't even talk about a friend of mine who started the church in San Francisco in a laundromat with seven people. You know what they did for a whole year? Laundry. They didn't have a worship service. They didn't preach. You know what they did for 12 months? People's laundry. People would come into a washateria and they would wash their clothes, pay for it, fold them up, and tell them Jesus loves you. They now run over 1,000 people, and all they did was laundry for 12 months for people. You say, but I'm just a hairstylist. Well, you got them. You got them right there for 3 hours. Got them. While the foil's in their head, you got them. Shoot. What, you getting a foil today? Good. I want to tell you about Jesus. I want to tell you about Refuge Church. Right there. So while their hair is cooking off their head, you got them. I don't care if you work at a grocery store or you do landscaping, you're a veterinarian. I don't care if you're a doctor, a lawyer, a plumber. God can use you. I believe there's something special here. Can I tell you, friends, and people are going to continue to come to Refuge Church. You're going to have to bust out a wall. I'm sorry, but you're going to have to do something. You said, we got 2 services. You might have to go to 3. Covenant, my church, we had 4. We had a Saturday night at 7. We had a Sunday morning at 8, 10, and noon. We had 4 services. What has God called you to do? Don't allow life to distract you with the enemy's flames and smoke to get you. God sees you. Nothing you're going through has caught him off guard. Can I tell you, it wasn't like a punch that God didn't see coming. God's not up there going, I never saw that guy. God knew. He knows everything you're going through. And he's going to catch you. So jump. Amen. Give the Lord praise one more time. Amen.